Very good, Sir Charles.
Simplicity itself. A walking stick left at our residence by an unknown visitor. However, the trail, like a labyrinth out of an ancient myth, led eventually to what my friend, Sherlock Holmes, described as the greatest and most dangerous case in the history of his career. It ended with a kind of reckless trial, and along the way, it renewed my respect for the greatest man I have ever known.
Dr. Watson, look at this cane. That man last night must have left it here when you and Mr. Holmes at the opera. Oh, so romantic leaving a stick like this by the fireside.
Good morning, Watson.
Morning, Holmes.
Morning.
Have you seen this cane yet, Mr. Holmes? I really wonder who left it.
Well, that's not a problem now, is it? It says right here on the funeral, to Dr. John Mortimer, good luck, from his friends at CCH. What do you make of it, Watson?
Oh, well, applying your methods, Holmes, though I'm sure I could never equal them, I'd say that because the stick is scratched at the bottom, the man likes to take long walks, and he lives in the country. Therefore, CCH stands for Country Club Hunt. And because such a gift is generally given upon retirement, I would say that the fellow's a successful, elderly, medical man who has lived in the country his entire life and is obviously well-beloved by all his friends.
Excellent, Watson. Truly remarkable.
Am I correct then, Holmes?
No, you're clearly wrong.
Oh, bugger.
But you inspire me, Watson. Like John Falstaff, you are not only witty in yourself, but that the causes wit in other men. In point of fact, Al Kane tells us that Albert Mortimer is a young man who used to work at CCH, Charing Cross Hospital, here in London. He is amiable, unambitious, absent-minded, and the possessor of a favourite medium-sized dog.
Oh. Mr. Holmes, sometimes I think I'd marry you if it wasn't for such filthy habits.
Trifles, Mrs. Hudson. It's a parlour game. He is Dr. Mortimer, so CCH must stand for Charing Cross Hospital. And he wouldn't leave such a fine practice if he were well established. So he must have been a student there. And as the date on the stick is 5 years old, we have a young fellow, under 30.
And the rest of it?
Well, the scratches on the cane indeed confirm he does live in the country now. And it's my experience that only amiable men receive testimonials. Only unambitious ones abandon London, and only absent-minded ones leave their sticks and not their visiting cards.
Score.
And what about the dog?
Oh, being a heavy stick, the dog is held it tightly by the middle. The dog's jaw, as shown in this face, is too broad for a terrier and too narrow for a mastiff. It may have been... Ah, yes, a curly-haired spaniel.
Holmes, please, how could you have possibly known that?
Because I'm looking out the window and see the dog on our doorstep. Oh. And there's its ring of its own now. Mrs. Hudson, the door.
Right away, sir.
Now, Watson, the dramatic moment of fate. When you hear the step upon the stair of someone walking into your life and you know whether or not for good or ill, what does Dr. Mortimer, man of science, ask of Sherlock Holmes, specialist in crime, and can he relieve the tedium of our mortal existence? Come in.
Oh, my stick. Oh, what a relief. I wouldn't lose it for the world.
A presentation, I see.
Indeed, from Charing Cross Hospital when I moved to the country. As a student at the time, I take it I'm addressing Mr. Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, and this is my friend, Dr. Watson.
How do you do?
Oh, and this is Mrs. Hudson.
How do you do, sir?
Tea, Mrs. Hudson?
Oh, yes. I would quite love some. Oh, yes, right away, sir.
Shall I begin, sir?
Please.
I have here a manuscript.
Mid-18th century? Unless it's forgery.
1742, to be exact. Handed down for over a century, committed to me for safekeeping by my friend Sir Charles Baskerville, whose sudden death 3 weeks ago created so much excitement in Devonshire.
It appears to be a statement of some sort.
May I read it to you?
Have a seat.
Of the origins of the Hound of the Baskervilles.
Hound?
Know then that in the time of the Great Rebellion, the manor of Baskerville was held by one Hugo, of a most wild, profane, and godless nature. It chanced that this Hugo came to love the daughter of a yeoman who held lands near Baskerville. The maiden feared his evil ways and would ever avoid him. So it came to pass that one Michaelmas, this Hugo, with five or six of his wicked companions, stole down upon the farm of the maiden and carried her off. And when they arrived at Baskerville Hall, the maiden was placed in an upper chamber.
Click, click, click!
No, stop it, please!
Quiet down!
Well, Hugo and his friends sat down to a long carouse, as was their custom. Now, the maiden was like to have her wits turned by the singing and shouting, and in the stress of fear, she did that which might have daunted the bravest of men. By the aid of the ivy which covered the south wall, she came down from the eaves and began homeward across the moor. Now it chanced that some small time later, Hugo would find the cage empty and the bird escaped. Whereupon, rushing down the stairs, he sprang upon the table and cried,
"If I can betake that wench this very night, I shall render up my body to the powers of evil! Now, saddle my mare, and get on my pack, and set the hounds upon her!"
Yeah! Taking to their horses in pursuit, the revelers were gone a mile when they came upon a shepherdess and cried to her to know if she had seen the hunt. The woman was crazed with fear, could scarcely speak, but at last recounted,
"I have seen the maiden and the dogs, and then Sir Hugo passed me upon his mare, and there ran behind him such a hound of hell as man has ever looked upon."
The drunken squires rode on, but soon their skin turned pale, for they came upon the dogs, very known for the valour of their breed, were whimpering in a cluster at the head of a ditch. And there in the moonlight lay the unhappy maiden, which had fallen dead of fear. But it was not the sight of her body lying nearby, or that of Sir Hugo, which raised the hair upon the heads, but standing over him, plucking at his throat, was a foul thing, great black beast, shaped like a hound, yet larger than any hound that ever mortal eyes rested upon. And even as they watched, the thing tore the throat out of Sir Hugo.
Continue.
I am here because of the sudden death 3 weeks ago of my friend and patient, Sir Charles Baskerville, the very same estate in Devon. The verdict at inquest was death by natural causes.
But
I got there before the police came, and at inquest I was reluctant to feel certain observations for fear of endorsing local superstitions.
I'm rather fond of observations, Doctor. Pray continue.
The day had been wet. The footprints of Sir Charles would be up and walking behind the house to the gate where he seems to have waited. He then continued, but his footprints changed. He appears to have walked on tiptoe from that point on to the spot where he fell. I then examined the body, which had not yet been touched. He lay face down, his arms out, his fingers dug into the ground. And when I turned him over, his features were convulsed with such strong emotion that the hardest part of his identity. There was certainly no physical injury of any kind, and yet there was no disturbance near the body. There were marks on the ground several yards away.
Footprints?
Footprints.
A man or woman?
Mr. Holmes, these were the footprints of a gigantic hound.
You saw this?
Clearly.
And you said nothing?
What was the use?
How is it that no one else saw it?
The marks were 20 yards from the body.
There are sheepdogs on the wall.
This was no sheepdog.
You say it was large.
Enormous.
Oh, if only I'd been there. You should have sent for me.
I didn't think of it besides.
What is it? You hesitate.
There were incidents before the tragedy. Several people say they saw a creature that corresponds exactly with the Baskerville demon of legend. Creature from a nightmare with dripping jaws and blazing eyes. Gentlemen, there's such a reign of terror over the district that no one will ever cross the moor at night.
How may we assist you?
By advising me what to do with Sir Henry Baskerville, who arrives at Waterloo Station exactly 1 hour.
He is the heir?
Yes, he's an American who lives in Texas.
And why not take him to the home of his fathers?
Think of the history, the danger. What can I do, gentlemen?
First, I advise you to call off your hound, who is scratching at my door with the zeal of a Christian. Next, take a cab and collect Sir Henry.
And then?
And then meet me back here. I'll advise you how to proceed. Good morning.
Goodbye.
Oh, goodbye.
I like it, Watson. There's a feverish quality to this unlikely tale that appeals to me.
You going out?
I am, unless I can help you in some way.
Oh, no.
But when you stop by Bradley's, can you ask them to send up a pound of their strongest shag tobacco?
This was the moment that everything changed. Holmes had smelled the bait, and I sensed that we were on the verge of another one of his strange roller coaster adventures. I also knew tobacco was the engine he required in these moments of such intense mental concentration. So I stopped at Bradley's.
That would be 2 and 6 pence of the best shag tobacco in the country.
I had it sent round, then returned that evening. Holmes? Where are you, Holmes?
Caught a cold, dear man.
No, it's just this poisonous atmosphere.
Oh, it is rather thick.
But as a medical man, you'll admit that smoking is good for the health?
I will admit no such thing. Now, how is the case coming along?
There's certainly some points of distinction about it, that changing frequency, for example. What do you make of it, Watson?
Mortimer said the victim began walking on tiptoe at some point.
He was running, Watson, running desperately for his life until his heart burst out of his chest and he fell dead on the spot.
Running from what?
There lies our problem. There are indications that the man was literally crazed with fear.
His face, you mean?
That, and I believe something dangerous approached him from across the moor. Only a man who's lost his wits would run away from the house instead of towards it when he was threatened. And why was he waiting in the yew alley? And who was he waiting for that night?
The thing, it takes shape, Watson. It becomes coherent.
Quick, your hat. We're late. What? The opera? Nothing like a little musical mayhem to clear the mind.
Motionless, as though in a trance induced by the discordant harmonies that swirled around us. I have no doubt, however, that his brain was racing a mile a minute, sorting clues like a ciphering machine, while on the stage below us, a woman named Floria Tosca was taking her revenge on the evil Baron Scarpia, acting out the kind of ruthless murder that had become part of our daily lives.
It's good to meet.
Likewise, it's a pleasure.
I understand, Mr. Holmes, that you figure out little puzzles for people. If my new friend here hadn't arranged for us to come around this morning, I'd have come myself.
You've had a remarkable experience then?
I wouldn't call it remarkable exactly. Just this oddball letter that arrived at my hotel room this morning.
To Sir Henry Baskerville, Northumberland Hotel.
Who knew you were going to Northumberland?
No one could have possibly known.
Except yourself.
Well, yes, but we only started to stay there after we met at the station. Yeah.
Good heavens! All the worse we can't have a magazine or a newspaper. Except the last one. As you value your life or reason, keep away from the law. I take it you talked to Henry about the hound.
Yes, I have.
And it sounds like hogwash to me. A big old hound with blazing eyes who breathes fire? Hell! I got hounds back home that could eat him for breakfast and spit out the bones.
Watson, do you have a copy of this Times?
Right here.
There's an interesting article on the front page about free trade. Listen carefully. You will see that it stands to reason that your wealth will keep away life of the country, which...
Aren't we getting a bit off the trail here?
On the contrary, I'm hot on the trail. You see the words in the article. You, your life, reason, keep away from that. You see the words in the letter. You, your life, reason, keep away from that. They were cut into a copy of this very article.
That's remarkable. How did you hear that?
Come now, Doctor. It's my profession. I know every print of every newspaper in the country. Though I will confess that once, when I was very young, I confused the Dover Express with the Oxford Mercury. I couldn't leave my house for weeks.
Well, why is the word more written out by hand?
Oh, the word is less common and therefore harder to find in print. Well done, Watson. Thank you. Have you observed anyone following you this morning?
Holy cow. It's like I walked straight into a dime novel.
I've seen no one.
The point remains whether Sir Henry should go to Devonshire or not.
No, it don't remain. That's my property now. All 10,000 acres of it. I ain't gonna give it up for Nova.
Then do as I say and do it now. I want the two of you to walk back to your hotel at a brisk but not unreasonable pace. Dr. Watson and I will then meet you there for lunch at 1. Good afternoon.
I gotta confess.
Do not question me. Go now.
We shall see you later.
Go, go. Quick, Watson, you have a moment to lose.
What in the shall I stop them?
Not for the world, dear friend. We'll follow them. Back in the yard. Quickly, quickly, onto the street.
Oh, look at him.
Boys, I recall you have a lad named Cartwright who stood some errands for me in the past. Is he here?
Who? Cartwright!
Ah, he's a good lad, he is. I'll call him for you. He's been one of our regular since. Cartwright, get down here. Mr. Holmes wants to see you.
Come in, then.
And if you'd be so kind, I'd like a moment alone with him.
What?
Be quiet.
Alone!
Oh, doctor, of course you feel alone. You need a wife to take care of you.
Cartwright!
I'm right here, sir.
We'll leave it to you.
Thank you.
What?
We're going away!
No, I don't think we should.
Hello, Miss Holmes.
Dear Dr. Watson.
Hello, Cartwright. How are the rest of the boys?
Oh, they're regular, sir.
They're doing all right with the occasional odd job now and then. Though they weren't my little extra work on their plates that became a colon in the scheme of things.
We certainly wouldn't.
Who's that?
The name's Milker, sir. I work with Cartwright when there's a shilling or two in circulation, if you see what I mean. So what do you think?
Fine, it'll speed things up. Now, you see this hotel directory? There are 23 hotels in the neighborhood of Charing Cross.
I see them.
Got it. You will visit each of them in turn.
Yes, sir.
You will start by giving the porter 1 shilling.
Yes, sir.
You will say that you're looking for a lost telegram.
Yes, sir.
But what you're actually looking for is this page of the Times with some words cut out.
Yes, sir.
Will you both stop saying yes, sir?
Yes, sir.
Now, in about 23 cases, the waste of the day before would have been burnt. But in 3 cases, you'll be shown a heap of paper, of which you will look for this page of the Times with some words cut out. The odds are enormously against you finding it. And I'd like you to report back as soon as possible.
Yes.
You've got it, sir.
And may I say, what a pleasure it is entering your employment, Mr. Holmes.
And you, Dr. Watson.
And now,
like a runaway horse,
or a speed train,
or a spotted leopard,
or a genie in a bottle,
or a fan,
or a ghost,
or a bullet,
or a sap.
We're doing Northumberland Hotel. I know a desk clerk there. It is a Castilian.
She waits on the floor!
Mr. Holmes, what a pleasure, sir. And Dr. Watson. I've read about your exploits in the Strand magazine religiously. Sir Henry Baskerville is expecting you upstairs, sir.
Do you have any objection to my looking at your register?
Not in the least, sir. Ni registerio est dun registerio.
No one's checked in since Sir Henry arrived.
That is correct, sir. We try to keep up the lift and the raft because, as you know, our hotel is the most proper in all of London.
If no one's checked in since Sir Henry arrived, that means they're anxious to watch Sir Henry, but equally anxious not to be seen by him.
You mean he might be recognised?
Well,
look, he's coming.
It's an old friend.
Inspector Lestrade of Scotland Yard.
Let's hope he does not derail the investigation this time.
Well, not be senseless. Mr. Sherlock Holmes, what the hell are you doing here? Hello, Doctor.
I'm meeting a client. How about you?
They're wasting me bleeding time with some piss poblonia and some baronet.
Sir, your language, please.
What about it?
This is a public hostelry. We have children here.
Wah!
You see what you've done? I'm used to the island.
I'm impressed. My mother speaks Italian too. If you ask me, it's a lot of bollocks about some tough from America who's going to inherit some fortune anyway.
Ah, he's my client, actually.
Good, because I got another case in Oslo involving some bleeding bastard is naked, mistress.
Aye!
Wah!
This is outrageous. He's spoiling the prestige of our hotel and he will ruin us!
God darn it!
Oh, Sir Henry, what's the matter?
I'll tell you what the matter is. They're playing me for a sucker here in this hotel. If they don't find my boot, there's gonna be trouble.
You lost a boot?
Not just our boots. It's my favorite pair. And they just lost one of them. Does that make any sense in the world? Hey, you!
They got me!
She's the maid who I talked to earlier. Miss, haven't found my boot yet. Now tell me the truth, because if you were in on it...
No, sir. I've not found the boot. I swear. I'm asking the boot black. I'm just not thinking. And I look in the cupboards. And I look on the shelves. And I meet their families.
Well, either that boot comes back before sundown, or I'll talk to your manager.
I promise. I find those boot.
Ah, Dr. Mortimer.
I'm sorry I'm late.
It's cold.
Bitter? It's not just bitter. It's downright freezing.
Danke.
Yes, it's
thank as well.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Holmes. It just gets in my craw when someone tries to play me for a sucker. I know it ain't important in the old scheme of things.
On the contrary, I believe it's quite important.
You do realize you were followed this morning after you left us?
Really?
By who?
Dr. Mortimer, do any of your acquaintances in Devonshire have a black beard?
Barrymore does. Sir Charles's butler.
And did Barrymore profit from Sir Charles's wills?
He and his wife were both given £500 each. But I trust a bequest doesn't make one a suspect. I received, well, £10,000.
That's a lot of money.
Yes, it is.
Anyone else?
It went to a few charities, and the residue went to Sir Henry.
And how much was that?
£740,000.
Good God!
Sorry. Excuse me. Quite enough money to provoke a murder, don't you think?
When Dr. Mortimer told me the amount of the legacy, I almost fell off my chair.
And if anything happened to Sir Henry, who would inherit?
I've heard talk of a black sheep son of Sir Charles's brother Roger, but I believe he died some years ago in South America.
And you're married?
That's right.
No children?
I sure hope not, but I can't swear to it. Ah!
Have you made a will?
Nope.
Well, I do believe you should go to Devonshire and claim your inheritance. There is only one proviso. You must not go alone.
Dr. Mortimer's coming with me.
But Dr. Mortimer has his practice to attend to, and I presume his house is anywhere near the manor?
4 miles away.
There you are. You must take someone trustworthy who will stay by your side.
Could you come yourself?
Oh, no. There's a scandal threatening the King of Bohemia that requires my attention at the moment. However, if my friend would agree, you'd have no better companion, nor any braver.
Me? That's a very kind way to put it,
but
it
would be kind of you, Doctor, if you're up for it.
Well, I don't think I'm the man for it, but I'll do it.
Excellent!
Okay.
The matter's concluded then.
Wait till we part. Shall we say Paddington Station today at 4?
Oh, done.
Done! It's okay, you got this.
Just
breathe.
I've never been on my own before. I don't want to go.
It's okay. Wait, I don't want to go. Watson, you are my eyes and ears, and I must know everything. I've made some inquiries and learnt that a man escaped Princetown Prison, which is close to Baskerville. There is also a scientist living nearby with his sister. His name's Stapleton. As well as the Barrymores, the butlers, of whom I hear rather sinister rumours. And of course, our friend, Dr. Mortimer, of whom I believe to be an honest man, but of actually we know very little.
You should be more trusting, Holmes.
Oh, I'd be more trusting if he had inherited £10,000, on which theory we should add Sir Henry himself to our little gallery.
Sir Henry? I know we've just met him, but he seems like he... I must say that he... I heard that... He's so American, it couldn't be him.
Well, he inherited close to £1,000,000, and someone killed Sir Charles Baskerville.
Oi there, excuse me. Are you the owners of the house at 221B Baker Street?
That's right.
I understand you wanted some words with the driver of the cab number 2704. Now what you got against me?
I have nothing against you, madam. On the contrary, I have half a sovereign for you if you'd answer some questions.
Well, I'm having a good day, aren't I? How can I help you?
Tell me about the man with the black beard who watched my house at 10 this morning and then followed two gentlemen down Regent Street.
Now what's the good of me telling you? You know as much as I already do. The gent told me he was a detective and that I was to keep me trapped shut, as it were.
My good woman, this is serious business and you'll find yourself in a bad position if you try to hide anything.
Tell me where you picked him up and all that occurred.
Well, this gentleman ailed me at 9:30 this morning at Trafalgar Square and offered me 2 guineas if I would do as he wanted. First, we drove down to Northumberland and waited there till two gents came out. And then we followed them till they stopped at your place.
And then?
And then they came out of there and we followed them again. Only this time my gentleman sees you on the street and he throws up the trap and cries, "Or you, drive as hard as you can to Waterloo Station." And I got him there in 10 minutes and away he went.
And did this detective of yours give a name?
Yes, he did. As he left the cab, he said, "It might interest you to know, young woman, that you have been driving Mr. Sherlock Holmes."
What?
What? Oh,
thank you, thank you. You've been very helpful.
Thank you.
What a foe, Watson. The cunning rascal. He spotted who I was at Regent Street, knew I would find the driver of the cab, and sent me back this audacious message.
The man is bold, if nothing else.
He's a creature of tangles. He's weaving a web whose intricacies we are barely glimpsing. I'm afraid I'm uneasy about sending you on this dangerous mission. You do have your revolver, I suppose.
I thought it best to take it with me.
Keep it near you, day and night. Never relax your precautions. Ah, Dr. Mortimer, Sir Henry, right on time. Did you find your boots, Sir Henry?
He did not. I suppose it's gone forever.
How very intriguing. Sir Henry, heed my instructions and follow them to the letter.
Instructions?
You must not cross the moor in the hours of darkness. It has a landscape that will try to seduce you with its morbid beauty, and you must not leave the house at all without Watson. Is that clear?
Well, I'll try, but I sure don't like being pent up.
All aboard!
Shall we proceed, Sir Henry?
Good luck to you. Watson,
Holmes.
Back of the train where we had left it far behind and saw the tall, austere figure of Holmes staring back at us.
I felt alone, yet I was on my mettle to do my best for Holmes and Sir Henry, knowing full well and without regret that there was danger ahead.
Grimpen Station! All off for Grimpen!
What? What? That was quick. Gentleman's coming on that one.
Oh, sir, you there, in the trap. Could you take us to Baskerville Hall for a shilling?
Baskerville Hall? Are you sure you want to go there, young fella?
Well, yes, I am.
Fair enough. Come aboard. If it don't kill you, it'll make you stronger. I believe that's how Nietzsche puts it. We'll put your hand on the door.
Right, yes, sorry.
Giddy up.
We proceeded through the moors of Devonshire, a landscape of such desolation and despair that we may as well have been visiting another, darker planet, where the limbs, the trunk, the very heart of nature were filled with malevolence. My heart grieved for the world around me, and then I saw it in its dark, forbidding glory, Baskerville Hall.
About gloomy. Reminds me of my mama's funeral. Without the liquor.
I'll ring the bell.
Good afternoon, sir. Welcome to Baskerville.
Welcome to Baskerville.
Ah, you must be Barrymore and Mrs. How do you do? How do you do? I'm Henry, and this is my friend, Dr. Watson. He'll be staying with us for a while, if that's all right with you.
Of course it is, sir. This is your house.
I guess that's right. I hadn't thought about it that way.
Ha! Would you wish the victuals to be served at once, sir?
The victuals?
Yeah, the victuals.
The victuals, sir. Your dinner?
All right, the victuals.
And there is hot water in your room if you wish to freshen first.
Yeah, I think we'll freshen.
And may I say that my wife and I will be happy to stay until you have made further arrangement for new staff.
You mean you're leaving? When it is convenient, sir.
But your family's been here for generations. I'd hate to start living here by breaking the connection.
We were very attached to Sir Charles. Sir and his untimely death has made these surroundings very painful for us. May we show you rooms, gentlemen?
We are welcome, sir. This way.
The portraits are absolutely beautiful!
This one is of Sir Hugo Baskerville, the one who stole their maiden in the 1700s. They say his neck was chewed off by the evil hound. This is not a very good way to die.
Lovely.
The view.
Pardon?
The view.
Right, the view.
Is what I said. The vista.
Of course, the more. It looks so lonely out there. You must be glad to have some company for a change.
No, not so much.
This room. My dear Holmes, I'm sorry for the infrequent bulletins, but I've slept little since arriving at Baskerville Hall. You know that I'm a creature of enlightenment and not given to flights of dramatic romanticism, but for several nights in a row, I've heard, in the distance, the strangled, muffled cries of someone torn by an uncontrollable sorrow. Meanwhile, Sir Henry remains in surprisingly good spirits.
Y'all got anything out here I can shoot?
We tend to explore the neighborhood tomorrow morning.
The net and I missed him. 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 Dr. Watson. Oh, Dr. Watson. Over the rock.
Oh, right. Yes.
Oh. Over that rock as well.
So.
Please excuse my presumption, sir, but Dr. Mortimer told me you had arrived last week. I am Stapleton of Mary Pitt House. I live nearby with my sister Bella.
Oh, how do you do? You're a naturalist, I hear.
Indeed. Butterflies are my passion. Whoosh! Got it. Duck. And we're so glad you came. We were so afraid that the new baronet might refuse to live here after the death of poor Sir Charles. You've heard of the legend of the Hound, I suppose.
Yes, I've heard it.
It is extraordinary how gullible some of the locals are. Some swear they've actually seen the beast. I have no doubt that the story led to Sir Charles' death.
How so?
Well, I saw Sir Charles earlier that day, and his nerves were so worked up that the sight of any dog would have caused a heart attack. That's my view, but the real question is, what does Sherlock Holmes think?
I beg your pardon?
Oh, come on. You are the Dr. Watson. Even down here, we read your recollections. So if you're here, that means Sherlock Holmes is interested in the matter. Hmm? Am I right? When's he coming?
I am so sorry, but I'm afraid that I cannot answer that question. There.
Of course you can't. But if I can be of any assistance, just say the word. It's a wonderful place, the moor. So vast and barren. You cannot imagine the secrets it contains. You see those bright green spots scattered around?
Yes, they appear more fertile than the rest of it.
Fertile? That is the great Grimpenmeyer!
The Grimpenmeyer?
One false step means death to man or beast. Only the other day, I saw one of the moor ponies wander into it. He never came out. I saw his head craning for quite a while. Then suddenly, it shot upwards! And it got sucked down, never to come out again.
But then why do you ever go near the Grimpenmeyer?
Because that is where the specimens are. And that is... Look! It's the Cyclopides.
The what?
I'll be right back!
I don't know what that is.
Get back here!
Oh, oh, be careful, sir! You're heading right for the... Oh, for the mire! For God's sake, man! Go back! Go straight back to London, instantly!
Why should I go back?
I can't explain, but for God's sakes, do what I ask.
But I've only just arrived.
Can't you tell when a warning is for your own good?
Oh, yes, but
start tonight. Get away from this place as soon as possible.
Shh.
Jack's coming. Not a word left.
Would you mind getting that orchid for me amongst the mortals yonder? Oh, and look at that bunny. Isn't he adorable?
Jack, you're so flushed. Did you catch him?
No. I missed him. I see you've met our visitor.
Yes, I was just telling Sir Henry here that it's getting rather late for him to see the true beauties of the moor.
What?
I said I was telling Sir Henry here.
What? This isn't Sir Henry. You thought this was Sir
no. A humble commoner, I'm afraid. The name is Dr. Watson, General Surgeon. How do you do? You must think I'm awfully silly. We've been talking across purposes.
Come, my dear. Let's show Dr. Watson out into our boat. We can have some tea to warm us up.
May I ask you a question first? Why do you live in this part of the world? It's so lonely, almost primeval.
Ah, well...
Where? We had a school in the North Country for a time, but alas, the fates were against us. An epidemic broke out and three of our boys died. There were no accusations, of course, but the school never quite recovered. And much of my capital was swallowed up. With what was left, we bought Merry Pit House, and now we're quite fond of...
What's happening again?
Huh?
What?
What's...
What? There it is.
There's what?
It's what?
What's
it? Shh!
What?
It's the blue Cyclops. I won't be a moment.
It's a bug.
Get back here, you devil!
It's just a butterfly. Oh, Dr. Watson, I'm so sorry to have mistaken you for Sir Henry.
Oh, no worry about it, but why were you so eager to get him out of here?
I know about the curses all. Please be frank with me, Miss Stapleton. Ever since I've arrived here, I've been conscious of shadows everywhere. This whole world of yours seems all mud and darkness with no trail to follow, with patches of danger to suck you in.
But that's what life is, Doctor. There is nothing else. There is no escape.
Hello? Dr. Watson?
Oh!
You know, I get mighty tired of just sitting there doing paperwork while you're out here having a good... Hi. I mean, how do you do?
My name is Oh My Lord, Your Beautiful Eyes. I mean, I shouldn't have said that. Should I?
Of course you should. I mean, it's quite all right. I'm Miss Stapleton. Beryl, I live here on your mouth. Your moor! I mean, I live here on the moors. Because they're so beautiful. I'm being silly again.
Again? When were you ever silly?
Just a moment ago, I was telling Dr. Watson here that you should leave, but I told him to leave because I thought he was you, but you're you and he's him, so he's not you, is he?
No, he's not.
She was very upset about it. She insisted.
You make too much of it, Doctor. My brother and I were shocked by the death of Sir Charles, so... When his heir came to live here, I became distressed.
You were distressed? For me?
I was. I am. You should go for your own sake. Why live in a place that has been fatal to your family? A place of danger.
Because it is the danger. That makes life interesting. Besides, maybe it's a place of something else. Or am I mistaken?
No, I think you are not mistaken. And yet it's foolish. You should go back while you still have the chance. The danger here is very real and not something to laugh off because of momentary feelings of... There it is. The hound. It never stops. It howls and cries and brings nothing but death. It's not a myth. It can hurt people and kill them and make them suffer.
Beryl.
I beg of you, please listen to me. Save yourselves. You'll be killed.
And then capering over the rocks like a sprite. I have begun to think of him as the man of mystery. How curious.
Yeah, it's curious, right?
Very curious.
Gives me curiosity.
And wonder.
And surprise.
And amazement.
That's enough. I have seen him for several nights in a row, but not for the past 2 days. He seems to come and go and melt almost magically into the landscape. Ah, Watson, he is out there. Now, I'll tell you more about the Barrymores. The surprising development began last night. As you know, I'm a very sound sleeper, but I was aroused by a stealthy step passing my room. I got out of bed, saw a shadow in the hall. My instinct was to follow, but I thought better of it. I crept into Sir Henry's room and awoke him quietly.
Holy cat. Flo's gonna be murdered in my bed, like my Uncle Willie.
Something very strange is occurring. Follow me.
You got it.
What?
He was arrested. He was in prison.
He was in jail.
Oh. Incarcerated.
He is my brother. And he was a good boy, and I could never envision what is going to happen to him. As he grew older, he met wicked companions and went from victim to victim like a vicious dog. And he broke our hearts. He is starving on the swamp, and I gave him clothing and provision. So Henry, when you threw out your clothing last week, I gave them to Victor. I am very sorry.
Oh, that's all right. And I don't fault you, Barrymore, for sticking by your wife. We'll discuss this in the morning.
Very good, sir.
Very good, sir.
Just look at that light out there. That is a comedy. How far out do you think that line is?
Well, it can't be too far if they carry provisions out to him.
The dirty villain, that candle of his. This is my castle. Come on, let's go take it.
Let's go.
It's dark out here.
We should close on him rapidly. I'm sure he'll be desperate.
I wonder what Holmes will say about this. Ha!
Good God. You think there's any truth to them stories?
No. I've lived my life thinking the world is rational. It has to be.
I know, it's just my hands freezing.
Shall we turn back?
No, I won't do it. This is my land now. I ain't gonna give it up to some old hound dog.
Look, a light stuck in this rock. We must be close.
Victor!
No!
God, he's dead. Help! Help! Somebody help! Dr. Watts is dead!
however, deeply humiliated. Sir Henry carried me back to the manor, where I was attended by a doctor named Hamish McCann and his nurse, a Miss Malloy.
Lovely. I like that.
Now you shut them eyes, I'm right here.
This really is quite refreshing.
I'm not surprised.
Holmes? What are you? How did you?
I'm just checking up on you, Watson.
I'm fine.
You are not fine.
As I understand it, you were almost killed by that brute on the moor. Perhaps you should leave the case entirely. It's getting too dangerous.
Never!
I intend to see it till the end.
There are layers here, Watson. Layers on layers, and nothing adds up. On one hand, there's this Victor fellow, who is obviously violent, but comes out of the blue.
Surprise!
Yet he's connected to the Baskervilles through his sister, and I suppose there might have been a liaison between Mrs. Barrymore and Sir Charles, which Victor is out to exploit. Or revenge.
With Mrs. Barrymore? Oh, I doubt it. She's like something out of Frankenstein.
You would be surprised. And then there's the Barrymore husband, who sounds peculiar, but is harmless as far as I can see. And I suppose if his wife did have an affair, he might have killed Sir Charles out of revenge. But that shouldn't threaten Sir Henry. Unless this Barrymore's a maniac. Which is not impossible. And then there's Stapleton, who is obviously as mad as a hatter. But has nothing to gain as far as I can see. And of course, his sister Beryl, who could be the worst of the lot and is simply pretending to be the soul of innocence.
I wouldn't say that to Sir Henry. He's besotted with her.
All the more reason to worry about her. She could be using him to get the money.
Huh?
What have you learnt? Anything about the Hound?
No, but you know that man of mystery I wrote to you about? Well, I saw him up close the other night.
You did?
Yes. I was taking a final look round the grounds before going to bed, and there he was, standing on the rocks at the back. He comes and goes at will, like a phantom.
Is he anything like our friend Victor?
No. Different type entirely. This fellow seems older and slightly out of his head from the way that he mutters and gibbers and shambles along. I'm sure that when you see him, you'll learn a great deal more.
Well, I won't, I'm afraid.
Why not?
Because I'm leaving.
What, again?
I'm sorry!
But Holmes, you...
I couldn't possibly stay in press of work, the behaviour of business.
You've just arrived.
I'm sorry!
Have you seen Sir Henry at least?
No, I don't want to. He'll make a fuss. I just wanted to make sure you weren't dead or something.
Well, I'm not,
apparently! Now, you must stay. Keep me informed. And you must keep a closer eye on Sir Henry.
Right.
Hey, Doctor!
There he is.
All yours.
Oh, Holmes, just wait a moment, please!
Doctor!
I'm coming! Holmes!
Hey, Doctor. I'm just going out by myself for a spell. Me, to tell you the truth, I'm going out to meet Barry.
Oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, I am.
Stop. Sir Henry, you listen to me. You know what Holmes said. You can't go out onto the moor unaccompanied, and that is final.
Now, listen. I've got two answers for you. First of all, we've been through a lot together, so you need to stop calling me Sir Henry. I'm Henry, and I can call you John.
John?
Okay. John Boy. Or Barbara.
John Boy.
You got it. Second of all, Mr. Holmes and all his wisdom did not foresee certain romantic developments which have transpired since I've been here. And I'm sure you ain't a spoil sport, right? Now, you take a nap. And I'll catch you later.
No, wait a minute, Sir Henry!
Don't move! Still look beautiful.
You spoil me terribly.
Good, because I mean to. Now, listen, I've been thinking about a lot of things.
That's excellent. I hear that thinking is very good for the brain.
Now you're making fun of me.
Just a little. You are from Texas.
And you live in a swamp.
It's not a swamp, it's a moor. And, well, at least we don't have crocodiles and kangaroos.
That's Australia.
Huh, right. I tend to get the colonies mixed up sometimes. They all seem to have cowboys and uprisings.
Miss Stapleton, you're interrupting my interruptions. And I want to say my piece.
All right, I suppose you're allowed to talk now and then.
Good, because I want to marry
you. Oh my God, I never thought, yes, I would go anywhere in the world with you. But you have to promise me we'll leave this place. We can't stay here, it's not safe. It's a place of danger.
Beryl! Oh. How dare you? How dare you? So what do you think you're doing? This is my sister! Do you think you can just walk into Baskerville Hall and take her away from me? Because you're a baronet!
Just for God's sake!
Let me assure you, sir, that my intentions are honorable.
Honorable?
Yes, in fact, I've just asked your sister to marry.
Marry? Baron, come in!
You have no right to speak to
her. Speak to her? Have you? Are you?
Baron? You hound, you leave her alone!
No, Henry, just leave it, it's hopeless.
Baron? You come with me. I'll speak to you later. Sir.
Holy cow! You should have seen what I just seen.
I did. I saw all of it. I hated to spy on you, dear fellow, but I thought it better if he didn't see me.
No, that's all right. But why in the world would you act like that? Do you think he's crazy?
I suppose that it's quite possible. Yes.
I think he needs a straitjacket. I mean, what's he got against me? I've got plenty of money. I ain't never hurt anybody.
Oh, Henry. I've come to apologize. I suppose I overreacted.
You suppose, do ya?
You must understand that my sister is everything to me. It's been just us, the two of us, since we were children. And I had no idea that you two had... that you two had fallen in love. I am deeply sorry.
Well, that's very handsome of you.
Perhaps you could dine with us this Friday. We could make amends. But I must ask one thing, even now, and that is to let matters rest until then, just so I can get used to the idea. and then I will withdraw any opposition to the match without hesitation, and that is my promise.
Well, I suppose a few days ain't too bad.
I'll see you then. Very good.
Bye, Henry.
It was now, dear Holmes, that events began crowding thick and fast upon us, and I had soon sensed that our lives were hurtling, without control, towards a remarkable and inevitable conclusion. The fuse was lit by Mrs. Barrymore.
You cannot tell them.
But I must.
Please, Mrs. Barrymore, go ahead.
We're listening.
You and Dr. Watson have been very kind to us, and we thought we should tell you. We do know something involving the violent death of Sir Charles.
You mean you know how he died?
No, not precisely, sir. But we do know why he was at the gate at the time of the night.
It was vigil to meet a woman.
Who was she?
We do not know her name, sir.
But her initial was LL.
You see, your Uncle Charles had a letter the morning he was killed. When I looked at it, I saw that a woman's handwriting, and then I told Inge about it.
And I do not think of it again for weeks and weeks. But then, when I was cleaning out Sir Charles' study, I found the ashes of Burns' letter at the back of the grave. Most of it was charred to pieces, but one piece was stuck together like little precious paper babies holding hands. I could read it. It said, "Please, as you are a gentleman, burn this letter and meet me by the gate at 10 o'clock. I feel so vulnerable. L.L."
Have you got the slip?
No. The babies crumbled as I moved them.
And you have no idea who L.L. is?
We do not know that, sir.
But if you find the lady, you will learn things, yeah?
Did Sir Charles have any lady friends or girlfriends, you might say?
No, so he was over 50?
May we go now, sir?
Oh, of course you may.
50 years old.
Girlfriends?
Oh.
L.L.
Does that remind you of anybody?
I'm afraid not.
Me neither.
We need someone who's acquainted with everybody in the district.
Dr. Mortimer! Let's go! Oh, Wendy!
I think he lives round here someplace.
Wait, there he is! Dr. Mortimer!
We need to speak to you.
I'm heading home. Where are you two going?
We're headed to your house. Need to ask you something.
Well, go ahead!
We're looking for a woman with the initials LL.
What?
We're looking for a woman!
So am I! I'm tired of being single!
No, a special woman!
Me too!
No, we have a clue!
Why do you need glue?
What?
I don't have any glue!
No, listen! We're looking for a woman so we can ask her some questions!
In my case, it's to have children! Shall we go inside?
God,
yes!
As far as I know. Her name is Laura Lyons. She has a typing establishment just down on Front Street, just down the road. She married against her family's wishes, the man deserted her, and now she desperately needs money for a divorce.
How terribly sad.
Wait a moment. There he is again.
There's who?
Man out there on the rocks, watching everything in the village.
The man of mystery.
Where does he live? Do you reckon?
I don't reckon. I know. I've seen him at the Black Tor. It's a rocky area with a hill above it. He lives in one of those stone huts.
Dr. Mortimer, you have patients waiting. I can't hold them off much longer.
Oh, excuse me, gentlemen. I've got to run.
The Black Tor.
He's high enough, madam, like it.
I'd like to confront him.
I'd like to do more than that. What are we waiting for?
Let's go!
It didn't look this high up from Dr. Mortimer's window.
I can see the hut down there at the bottom.
Where?
Right there.
Thanks, old timer. But I'm used to climbing hills back in Texas. I ain't gonna slip on this kind of ground. Are you okay?
Fine. Look, there's the hut, and it still has a roof on it.
There's nobody inside. Come on. Ain't no question somebody lives here. I mean, blankets, canned peaches.
This? It looks like a diary of some kind.
It says 3:42 p.m. Dr. Watson and Sir Henry have gone to see
Dr. Mortimer? Good heavens, what is this? What's going on?
We're being followed. And they're gonna be mighty close by. I'll go find them.
All right, but be careful. As noted earlier, Dr. Mortimer lives at the end of town, and I would guess that they plan to question him regarding Laura Lyons.
Come out of there, young man, or there's gonna be trouble!
Stay where you are. I have you covered.
You're covered as well. Now what will it be? Death for one of us?
Or shall we settle it over a nice cup of tea, my dear Watson? Holmes?
Hello, dear fellow.
Was it you all along?
I'm afraid it was. And I'm glad you applied your usual punch and shaving cream this morning, or I wouldn't have known it was you in the hut.
Oh, my dear Holmes, it's good to see you.
I didn't think you would find me this soon.
No, Mortimer saw you scrambling on the rocks.
Ah, and you've just been to see him to find Laura Lyons, I imagine.
Yes, but what are you doing here? I thought you were back in Baker Street working on that blackmailing case.
Ah, that's what I wished you to think. I thought if the two of us could explore the case independently, from different angles, we could make more progress. At the moment, I'm trying to track down this Miss Lyons.
Well, I think I've done it. Morton says she lives down on Front Street.
Oh! And your plan is to visit her, right?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Then we'll go together. You are aware that a close intimacy exists between the man Stapleton and Miss Lyons?
No, not.
Well, they meet and they write, and I believe we can use it to detach him from his wife so we can question her.
His wife?
Yes.
You mean Stapleton's wife?
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't aware he had one.
Oh, the woman Beryl, who passes as his sister, is in fact his wife.
What? That's just shocking. Beryl, that means that
He is our enemy. He must be. There is no other calculus that makes sense.
But how do you know that she is his wife?
Because he forgot himself. I did some sleuthing in the Times archives and learnt that a school in the north did indeed come to some unfortunate circumstances, as he described, and that the man who ran the school disappeared with his wife. I'm hoping to receive a photograph soon to confirm his identity.
What is that?
Where is it, Watson? Where is it?
There, I think. The hound. It's the hound. Come quickly, Holmes.
Ah!
Henry? He's killed Sir Henry. The brute. The brute. When I find him, Holmes, I swear to you that I'll put him away for life. Stapleton!
Stapleton! How dare he even touch my client? How dare he challenge me my very own game? How dare he? I would have him drawn and quartered in the public market place!
Holy cow. What happened here? Was that my cousin Dahl on a Friday night?
Sir Henry?
What's the matter?
Mr. Holmes!
Sir Henry, it's you're alive! Oh, how good to see you, I'm all of this! Oh.
Then this must be... Ah, it's Victor! My sometimes neighbor! The clothes, I'm a fool!
Of course, the Barrymores gave Victor Sir Henry's old clothing to keep him warm.
And the hound smelled the clothing!
What's going on?
What's going on is someone wants you killed, just as they killed Sir Charles before you.
But who could it be?
I think you'll find that Holmes... You'll find that Holmes has not figured it out yet, but he will soon, and he'll get back to you.
Anybody there?
It's Stapleton, the lion vermin. I wish he'd keep his nose out of my business.
Not a word to Sir Henry. You require his innocence or my plans crumble.
Dr. Watson, is that you and... What a pleasure to see you again, Sir Henry.
Likewise.
I wouldn't have expected to see you out on the moor like this. And is that a body, oh my dear?
That's Victor. The man who escaped from Princetown prison.
Oh dear me, and you must be Sherlock Holmes.
How do you
know? Have you solved the mystery of Sir Charles's death yet?
I'm afraid I haven't, which is why I returned so soon to London. I leave in the morning.
No, hang on a second. You just died.
Alas, Watson and I depart in defeat.
Watson too? And I lose a friend.
I'm sure we'll be down again quite soon, and until then, I trust that you'll visit us in London. Jack!
Jack, you know I don't like being left out here alone.
Henry, what a wonderful surprise. What are you doing here?
I was just out with some friends. You know, Dr. Watson and Sherlock Holmes.
How do you do?
Mr. Holmes, what a pleasure. We've been expecting you for so long. I'm so grateful, so pleased that you've come at last. This could change everything.
Why? Are you in distress, madam?
Now, why would you say that, Mr. Holmes?
Usually, only those in distress are glad to see me.
And the rest want to run away from you. Okay, and we shall still see you for dinner tonight, then. Very good! I'll have the Barrymores pack your things.
Thank you. What a nerve he has. He's as cool as one of his very own butterflies. Tempting capture and then fluttering away. I pray we could stop him before his next kill, but we have a train to meet. Let us repair to her tapping establishment immediately.
It was I who sent the letter to Sir Charles. It was I who begged him to help me. It was I who asked him to meet me at the gate. But I never went to the meetings, I swear.
You're lying.
I am not.
Of course you are. Now, regard this case as one of murder. And the evidence may implicate not only the man Stapleton, but his wife as well.
His wife? His wife? He's not a married man.
I'm afraid he is.
Prove it to me. Mm. I have here a photograph taken in York 4 years ago, endorsed Mr. and Mrs. Vendeleur, but you'd have no trouble recognizing him and his wife as well.
I believe he pretends she's his sister, Berylius. He lied to me. He offered me marriage if I could get a divorce from my husband. He kept me from going to meet Sir Charles at the gate. The villain, the blackguard, the evil man. How could he?
You have had a most fortunate escape, madam. You had him in your power and he knew it. I suggest that for your safety, you do not leave this room until tomorrow morning. Good afternoon.
Take care of yourself.
Now, Watson. Let's head to Baskerville Hall. It's time to set the trap and spring it.
Henry this time.
Yes, John Boy.
Sir Henry, heed what I say. Follow my instructions. You must take a cab and collect yourself in the cab to the dinner at Merriford House, and then send your cab home and tell them you intend to walk home. Yes.
Across the moor.
Exactly.
That's what you keep telling me not to do.
This time, you may do it safely.
Now, get up. Call for your cab, or you'll be late for dinner.
If you say so. But I don't like it.
I must say, this is rather hard on poor Sir Henry.
Poor Sir Henry will thank us profusely if I can arrange to keep him alone.
What is it, Holmes? What's the matter?
These portraits on the wall, they are, I take it, Sir Henry's ancestors.
Yes.
And are all of them Baskervilles?
That's right. The one you're staring at is Sir Hugo, the one who started it all. Is something wrong?
No. Nothing is wrong. In fact, something is right at last. I believe you think I know nothing of art, but you'll agree this portrait is remarkable.
Well, I'd say it's very lifelike, but I don't think that I call it remarkable.
Oh, I would, believe me. Just step back a little.
Right, yes, sir.
Now, I want you to imagine the portrait without the hat.
Right.
Without this heavy cloak he's wearing.
Yes.
Without all the hair.
Right, very good.
Now, does it remind you of anyone?
Do you mind if I...
Yeah, just come.
Right. I must get a new prescription, honestly. I suppose he...
He looks like Stapleton!
Same beady little eyes.
Same, would you say weak?
I would. Same weak, flabby chin. Same gone mortal teeth. Good heavens!
Exactly!
Stapleton, do it, Holmes. The beast is real. Very real. At least it appears to be.
I'm on to him, Watson. And by tonight, he'll be fluttering in my net as helpless as one of his very own butterflies. Now, let's head to the station. We have to meet Lestrade.
I stand by what I said. I don't think that was a good remark.
It was horrible. It's just so pretty. I understand your sympathy.
Well, anything good this time, or is it just some Maharaja's missing knickers?
It's the biggest thing in years.
Oh, you aren't?
There's a duck pissing a pond.
Thank you for such a vivid metaphor. Did you bring the warrant I asked for?
There's a bear going to the woods and...
Thank you. I need someone to help me arrest the singular most criminal mind I've ever come across.
Well, what are we waiting for? Let's go get the bugger and slam him to rights.
Excellent. Now, it's off to the moors.
Cheerful place now, is it, Holmes? Look there!
I see lights.
That's Merripit House, where Stapleton lives. He has killed one man and is trapping another.
Sounds like a slippery sort of character to me.
That's the understatement of your career, Lestrade. Now, Sir Henry will be heading out any minute. That is when Stapleton will try and kill him. We'll ambush him from here.
Ambush? I like the sound of that.
Watson, you've been in the house. What are those lacerated windows at the corner?
That's the dining room, I think.
Can you creep forward and see what they're doing? But... stay very quiet, and God help us if Stapleton gets wise.
They must be having dinner, the lucky buggers.
I'll be right back. Just checking the furnace.
Well?
What happened?
Dog, enormous dog, inside that building. And I saw no sign of Miss Stapleton at the table.
Oh, Lord, love a duck. Look at that.
What is it?
Look at the fog. It's like pea soup.
Oh, no. This is the one and only thing that could stop us.
Leave it to me. I'll get to higher ground and I'll holler if I see anything.
Good idea.
Go, go.
I move like a cat.
Damn Sir Henry for taking his time. His life and our success may depend upon him coming out before the fog obscures everything.
Why are the lights have gone out?
Come on, come on.
I can hardly see the path now. The fog has gotten worse.
Oh, wait. I think I hear something. He's coming out!
Good night. Thank you again. Sleep well.
I couldn't endure it all. The soul.
forgive you? I would forgive you any.
Oh my God.
What about that bugger Stapleton? Where'd he go?
That's what I want. Cause I'm gonna tar him, feather.
I know. There's only one place he could have fled. There's an old tin mine in an island on the heart of the mire. It was there that he trained his hateful hound, and there also he created a refuge in case he was ever found out.
But could he find it in the dark like this?
Yes. That is, he could have, but... Oh!
Tell us!
Knowing what he had planned this morning, I shifted all the markers that he uses to find his way in. Oh, I put them in circles around and round and down the hill to the deepest part of the
of the case took its toll on Holmes, for he was continually troubled by the conflict he felt between the atrocious nature of the crimes he dealt with and the thrill he took in their investigation. The hound, he said, was deep in all of us, the part of our souls that is dark and troubling, and it took him time to come to grips with it all. For my part, I was anxious to understand all the details of what had occurred, so that I could begin to chronicle his latest exploits. But it was a full month before I could get him to discuss the case, which he finally did on a Sunday afternoon when we were back at our flat in Baker Street.
Stapleton was indeed the son of Roger Baskerville, and when he learned that only two persons intervened between him and the title, he decided to kill them both. He settled in Devonshire for that purpose, learned of the legend of the hound, and that is when his genius came in. He used the legend to create the real thing, a gigantic mastiff, hidden, painted, and starved to do his killing. Meanwhile, his wife tried to warn Sir Henry with a letter and used cutouts in case her husband ever saw it. Stapleton stole Sir Henry's boot, which told me instantly there was a real hound involved. He needed the boot to give the hound the smell of the man. The one red herring in all of this was the convict Victor, who actually had nothing to do with the case, but clouded my judgment for a while, which was unforgivable.
As if in answer to Holmes' self-reproach, the doorbell rang at that instant. Henry and Beryl arrived, informing us that they were getting married as soon as the law allowed, and asking me to be their best man.
This calls for celebration. Let's go to the opera. My box is free, and the opera is Falstaff.
Oh! How fancy!
Oh my God!
He's up! I'm excited!
Oh, you should be. Henry, are you excited?
Yes.
He's not much of an opera
fan.
He
looks excited!
Job, that's all.
We're thankful to have something worth fighting for, something to help relieve the humdrum of our mortal existence.
Plot against Queen Dynamite!
Well, Watson,
yes, Holmes,
I believe the